Good morning. My name is Faith Reed, and I welcome you to our worship service. At Church of the Nativity, we believe all people are of sacred worth. We warmly welcome people of every age, language, race, ethnicity, sexual orientation, gender identity, physical and mental ability, economic means, marital status, and family structure into the full fellowship, membership, leadership, ministry, worship, and sacramental life of our congregation. As a loving and inclusive faith community, we welcome seekers, doubters, and believers. As we say in the United Church of Christ, no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. Pastor Scott will now share some announcements.
Thank you. Good morning, church. Welcome. Good to see all of you here at the mighty Church of the Nativity. As Pastor Dan says, the grace-filled Church of Nativity. I don't think he likes mighty. But good to see you all here in the building. To those who are with us on live stream, we are glad that you are together with us in the body of Christ. If this happens to be a first or second time that you might be among us, we extend a special welcome to you. There are little visitor cards in the pews, and we welcome you to fill those out as you see fit. I do want to thank those who are participating in the service today. We have some wonderful special music from Aaron Mason and Chrissy DeMar. There they are. Debbie McDuffie's team has greeted you here. Faith, our liturgist today. I see Dan and Ed and Bill. Whole cabal up there doing the AV. So thanks to all of those folks for making this work today. I'll call your attention to the printed announcements. I do have one sad announcement to bring, and that is to let you know that Ruth Grono passed away early this morning under hospice care. Many of you know Ruth as Helen Cerulik's mom, and Helen called and let me know that this morning. There will not be services for Ruth. That was her wish. But I really do hope that we will hold Helen, her brother's here from Florida, but the folks who are affected by this loss, hold them in prayer. This is a sad transition, of course, for Helen and for her family. Beyond that, note that giving statements are available across office if you have one that you might take and save us the cost of mailing. And the website, the registration is up for Vacation Bible School later on in August. Going to be a blast, and opportunities as well, even if you don't have a kid, to sponsor a kid. It's cheap. I think it's $10, and there are envelopes down on a bulletin board in the gathering space and a way to kind of be together as a church to support that important ministry to kids in the neighborhood, kids who we might not always see. And then just, you'll see a little announcement that your interim pastor cannot stop himself from talking, and so is blogging now. And there are blog posts, or there will be more, but find that on our webpage, and I think we'll be pushed out on Facebook as well if you care to read the blog. That's, I think, what we need to say by way of preamble. Surely the Spirit of the Lord is in this place, and so I hope that we will be in a spirit of expectation this morning as we look for the Holy Spirit to be at work among us.
Thank you.
join me in the call to worship. Be still and know that God is. And when all human striving has ceased, God will still be. Please be seated. Let us pray together the gathering prayer. God, when we're too sure of our own correctness, forgive us our arrogance. When we are quick to judge and slow to accept, forgive us our hard-headedness. May we live in your light that, like the sunlight, in the source of all growth and all joy, we pray in Christ's name. Amen. Our Bible reading for today is from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 13, verses 24 through 30, from the New Revised Standard Version, updated edition. He put before them another parable. The kingdom of heaven may be compared to someone who sowed good seed in his field, but while everybody was asleep, an enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat and then went away. So when the plants came up and bore grain, then the weeds appeared as well. And the slaves of the householder came and said to him, "Master, did you not sow good seed in your field? Where then did these weeds come from?" He answered, "An enemy has done this." The slave said to him, "Then do you want us to go and gather them?" But he replied, "No, for in gathering the weeds, you would uproot the wheat along with them. Let both of them grow together until the harvest. And at harvest time, I will tell the reapers, 'Collect the weeds first and bind them in bundles to be burned, but gather the wheat into my barn.'" So ends our hearing of these ancient words. May God's Spirit open our hearts and minds to understand the meaning they may hold for us today.
Thank you, Faith. So the weeds among the wheat is one of a series of parables that Jesus tells here in the 13th chapter of the Gospel of Matthew. These are parables about the kingdom of heaven, what it will look like when the whole world worships with its whole heart. And of course, some interpretations of the scriptures say that this kingdom will come as kind of a gentle evolution, and some say that it'll be a fiery second coming of Christ. But really, Jesus here is more concerned with what the kingdom is going to look like when it gets here. And like a good professor, like your favorite professor in college, right, he explains himself in similes. He says, the kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed. Kingdom of heaven is like yeast. It's like a treasure hidden in a field, like a merchant in search of fine pearls, like a net that was thrown into the sea. And today's parable, you really don't need me to say much more about it. I can sit down now, because Jesus, just a few verses later, the disciples come to Jesus and ask him to explain it, and he does. And he says this, "The one who sows the good seed is the Son of Man." Me, right? "Field is the world, and the good seed are the children of the kingdom. The weeds are the children of the evil one, and the enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the reapers are angels." And so in Jesus' explanation, this parable, the parable of the weeds among the wheat, is about his own ministry, about what he is doing in the world right then and down through the ages. And the ones who come to God through Christ are the wheat, the good crop, the staff of life, right? The food that sustains the world. And the children of the evil one, as Jesus puts it, are the unhelpful weeds in that are making themselves at home in Jesus' nice divine wheat field. And so in Jesus' explanation, the way he explains it, this parable really seems to be a very tidy allegory about a battle between good and evil. And the surprising part, and it's really the only surprising part that we read here, is his caution against trying to pull out the weeds. And gathering the weeds, he said, you would uproot the wheat along with them, let both of them grow together until the harvest. And then, of course, the weeds get their comeuppance. They are bound in sheaves and burnt. Now, I know a lot of us are tending gardens this summer at home, and I am guessing you gardeners might be like me. If I see a weed, I am all over it. Part of the joy of gardening is that if only a tiny little bit, you can curate nature. You can play God. You can make grow what you want, and you can consign the interlopers to an early death. We came back from a couple weeks of vacation recently, and there were crabgrasses the size of dinner plates in the flower garden. Terrible. I pulled them out before we even unpacked the suitcases. Yes. So I understand, anyway, how the servants of the householder in this parable, how they were feeling in this situation. Some disruptive entity has seeded their nice field with bad plants, and they want to get in there and pluck them right out. Jesus says no. But I think there's also a further caution in this parable that we might raise up to ourselves, and that is how it sucks us so easily into a kind of smug self-satisfaction. Because nobody reads this parable and they think, well, me, I'm the weeds, right? Because we are church people, we must be the wheat. We are followers of Jesus. And then when we think like that, the corollary follows hard on its heels, that the rest, all the rest of this crazy, busy, complex world must be the weeds. The parable tricks us, I think, into imagining ourselves as the righteous. And it makes Judge Judy out of all of us. We take a quick look at the case, whatever the situation is before us, and we make a snappy judgment in a Brooklyn accent. Right? But Jesus begs to differ. Leave the weeds alone, he says. You try to pull them out, you try to impose your own judgment, you just tear up the wheat. And so why is that? Why is that? I think it's because we cannot really know the weeds from the wheat. You really just don't know. You think you're pulling up a weed, but it turns out to be wheat. Or you think that you're leaving some wheat, it's really a weed. You just cannot know. Only God knows. And it's interesting that the Greek word that Matthew uses for weeds, that word is zizanion. And it refers to a very particular type of weed, and it's a weed that looks just like wheat as it's starting to grow. You can hardly tell the difference. And today this stuff is called darnel wheat. Looks like wheat, appears to be wheat, but it is not wheat. It fools you. I do not know a weed from wheat. I do not know a weed from a flower, says the great Disciples of Christ preacher Fred Craddock. I pulled back the swing blade, ready to assault this bunch of weeds, and here comes my wife, Nettie, saying, wait. And then that night at the supper table, there's that weed in a vase in the center of the table. Looked like a weed. I thought it was a weed. As a child, I plucked a dandelion and given it to you as a treasure. Weed or wheat? Right? Fred Craddock goes on, I do not know a weed from a flower, And every church I've known that tried to weed the garden made horrible, horrible mistakes. Because you see, that is God's business. God said, in the harvest, I'll take care of all of that. I am the only one who knows weeds from wheat. So you leave it alone. And yet, individually and as a society, I think it is really hard for us to leave it alone, isn't it? Our impulse so often, like me on the crabgrass, our impulse is to pull those weeds, what we see as weeds anyway, pull them out by the roots. We simmer with resentment over refugees crossing our nation's borders, the weeds in the wheat of, quote, real Americans. We look with suspicious eyes at people making ends meet with food stamps or welfare benefits, the weeds in the wheat of honest working folks. We fall behind political leaders who appeal only to their base of voters, who fabricate a world of us and them, an island of right-thinking wheat amid the ideological weeds. We see crazy clothing or hair or tattoos, and we see not human variety, but otherness. You know, a wheat field, that is uniform and beige. It's only the weeds that break it up, break the monotony, but we like uniform and beige. And like so much of Jesus' teaching, this parable takes our natural impulse, in this case, our readiness to rule in and rule out, to assign labels like good and evil, takes that and he stands that impulse on its head. Leave it alone, Jesus says. Let it be. The field is God's to sort out. And I finally just want to mention, it's worth mentioning that churches too can fall victim to this same temptation to judgment. There's a Lutheran pastor I like named Edward Marquardt, preaches in Seattle. And he remembers that while he was in seminary, his ideal congregation was a famous one called Church of Our Savior. And it's in Washington, D.C. And he writes this, among my peers and friends, that congregation was the ideal, the inspiration, the model to which we aspired. It was a small congregation, about 200 people, who renewed their spiritual vows each year. And their vows were to tithe their money, to attend Bible study every week, to pray every day, to be politically active for the poor every week. And they signed on the dotted line every year. These people were committed. That was my ideal community in my younger years. But not anymore, he says. Maybe I've matured, but now I want a community that is wide open to all people, including the uncommitted, the half-committed, the lukewarm, the confused, the puzzled, the materialists, the messed up, the addicted, the afflicted, community in which all of those folks are welcome. We want weeds and wheat in our church. And besides, I'm no longer sure which is which and who is who. Leave the weeds alone. Amen.
Aaron and I have been wanting to do this for a lot of years, but when we discussed what we were going to sing, we both kind of looked at each other and said, well, let's do it in the garden, because in your lifetime, there's always somebody who comes into your life that blesses you from beginning to end. And that was our friend Jan Butcherai. She's passed since, and so is her husband, who is also in love with the old songs as well. So we would like to do do this in memory of Jan, probably one of the best people who ever walked the face of this earth, right?
Amen.
Let's be together in prayer this morning. God, in the ever-widening circle of your love, we confess that too often we mistake the part for the whole. Jesus showed us the way of acceptance, calling us to account for our arrogance and the way we can rush to judgment. We think we are wheat among the weeds, when in fact all of us, every human being, is both of those things. And so, God, we offer ourselves before you this morning in hopes of becoming better, better disciples of Christ, more attuned to your ever-present grace, less hobbled by self-importance and self-involvement, more open to the idea that difference is only difference and not a threat to us. So this week we pray, put before us opportunities to learn and to grow. Help us rise to see that what look like challenging situations or challenging people may indeed be bearers of the gospel for us, right here, right now. And as always, we lift up those in our circle of concern whom we know need your special care in this time, those who are ill, those who are grieving, who are lost and alone. We raise up especially today thanksgiving for the life of Ruth and hold in prayer Helen and her family as they grieve this loss of her mom. May they know your peace in this hard time. We know, too, that you are with us in times of both trial and rejoicing, and so we give thanks for your presence in the joyous moments of our summer lives as well. And we pray for those situations in the world that do not know peace, in particular for those caught up in the conflict in Ukraine. And of course, we pray for Church of the Nativity, that this congregation might be a faithful witness to Christ in everything we do. So be with the person, we pray, who will become our next settled pastor. Be with the Pastoral Search Committee as they continue their difficult work of discernment and vision. God, we ask a lot. We offer our whole selves in return. We are your people. You are our God. And so hear us as we pray together Jesus' words of hope and healing. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
God calls us to generosity as we commit our time and money to Christ's work through our church. Many people donate through our website, and also the offering plate is next to the back pew. Thank you for your faithful giving. Let us pray together the prayer of dedication. Our gifts, our time, our very lives, these we offer to you, O God. May all of it be in service to your work in our church, our community, and our world. In Jesus' name, amen.
these words as we go forth, God draws that circle of love ever wider. Challenging as it is, may we do the same. Go in peace, go in joy, but most of all, go love. Amen.